Okay, so this is our December 2022 TICN presentation. Tonight we have Caro Kellough. Is that how you say your name?
Yeah, good job.
Okay,
yeah.
Awesome. Thanks. And yeah, so just briefly on TICN, we started in 2014. And mostly these days we just offer usually monthly, sometimes it's every other month, presentations on various trauma-informed modalities. We do a newsletter every so often to connect people to resources and let people know about various events happening in the therapeutic world. We haven't done one of those in a while, but one's coming up soon. and yeah, it's pretty much what we do. We kind of scaled down since COVID. So I'll introduce Caro. She is CMHC, has over a decade of backpacking and guiding experience. After receiving her master's in clinical mental health counseling at Lesley University in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Caro moved out west to forge a new path that would include mental wellness, the outdoors, and social justice. She's a fully licensed mental health counselor with a specialization in trauma and holistic mental health. She recently completed a 200-hour yoga teacher training and is certified to teach trauma-informed yoga. As a wilderness therapist and guide, Caro has worked for various guiding companies, including Outward Bound and Andrew Skirka Adventures, and has logged over 300 field days. She uses an eclectic set of clinical skills, but focuses predominantly on IFS, internal family systems, narrative therapy, and structural family systems. And before I turn it over to her, if either of you both are here for CEUs, if you could email me, I'll put my email in the chat and let me know, and then I'll email you with those. So yeah, I'll give it over to you, Caro.
Welcome. Oh, sorry. I'm getting ahead of myself. How do I go back? Oop, there we go. I think I'd figured out Zoom 3 years in. So yeah, welcome. Thanks for sharing your Friday evening. I know probably many people have holiday parties and finals and things that they're kind of wrapping up. But since it's such a small group, and I think we're only expecting like two more people. Sorry, if this gets annoying, I'll eventually turn off my email notifications. I will plan on kind of doing this in the same style in some ways, I guess, that I would do any kind of group out in the wilderness. And so I will be asking for some group participation. You know, if you feel like sharing, that would be great. I always say, if you don't feel like sharing, that's also okay. And we can always come back to you at the end. But I'm an experiential person. I like to use my hands. I like to like get up and do things. And so, while I'm excited to be here and giving a PowerPoint presentation, I also want it to be kind of like as interactive as we can. And hopefully you all will walk away with some, new ideas for what you can maybe do in your own practice. And maybe we'll do introductions in a little bit. But yeah, I wanted to start there. So first of all, the idea of wilderness therapy, especially in Utah, is something that I think we all hear, we've all heard about, or a lot of people have heard about. It's very big in Utah. It's usually targeted towards adolescents or older or like burgeoning adulthood kind of group. Usually it's focused on addiction work and family systems work. And that is definitely like one form of wilderness therapy. That's how I got my foot in the door. I used to guide for do more just the guiding part, but then bringing the therapeutic piece into it was me working in a wilderness therapy program where kids come from all over the country And they're there for like 8 to 10 weeks, living out in the West Desert, and doing therapy out there. So that's kind of maybe the, what's the word? The overarching idea of wilderness, or like the most common thing that we think about with wilderness therapy. But I'm trying to make the argument, I guess, that wilderness therapy is really all of, it's more like ecotherapy, which is incorporating wilderness, nature, environment into the work that you're doing. It doesn't have to be out in the middle of the woods in order for you to incorporate the themes that come up in a wilderness setting. So we want, the idea is for you to help you kind of bring the inside outside, both like literally and, you know, metaphorically. I have some notes over here. So yeah, the difference between wilderness therapy and adventure therapy is specifically targeted towards things like experiential adventure. So that would be like climbing, mountain biking, hiking. It usually the therapy is focused around some kind of group event. Wilderness therapy, when I'm using it, is more just based on therapy out in the wild. Ecotherapy, which is kind of also in this world, is, it describes a broad use of techniques and methodologies that use nature in order to improve mental health. And so that kind of, knowing those three definitions will hopefully help inform the rest of the way that this presentation goes and kind of how you can start to frame some of the interventions that I'm talking about. So the presentation will hopefully show you that even if you don't have access to the outdoors, if you're not doing walk and talk, if you're exclusively telehealth, that there are still approaches that you can use with your clients with a wilderness mindset that encourages them to do the same. All right. So the first little section that we're going to spend a little bit of time on is how wilderness therapy is effective in treating mood disorders. Most of the clients that come to wilderness therapy tend to carry diagnoses that include depression and anxiety. Other things like learning differences, neurodiversity often come up, addiction stuff often comes up, personality disorders sometimes come up, but not necessarily as frequently. And we find that wilderness therapy and outdoor-based therapies can have a really high effect on decreasing the symptoms of these individuals and increasing a lot of the good things that we want to get out of therapy. I'm gonna hide myself view so I'm not distracted. A little ADHD brain going on. So one of the things that we talk about in therapy in general, and I think especially in trauma work, is increasing our clients' window of tolerance. You know, the idea that a lot of our clients come to us in crisis or in a state where small things create a large reaction of distress. So one of the things that I think being outside in general can do when in a safe and compassionate environment can just inherently increase the window of tolerance, because it's requiring you on like a physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual level to adapt literally to your climate. So thing, you know, I would have kids often who had never, I had one kid come in who had never cooked for himself in any way, shape, or form. And the first night we taught him how to boil water to make ramen, things like that, where he, almost immediately right off the bat, they're having to adapt to the environment. And there is a sense of urgency, I think, when you're in a natural environment to survive. but let's not be, you know, these are not survival techniques. These are mental health survival techniques, maybe. Another thing that it can help with is self-regulation and soothing. When you're out there without any kind of maybe technological advantage of distraction, it becomes really imperative that you start learning coping skills and start learning them kind of quickly and thinking outside the box of what self-soothing really can be. If you don't have things like your phone readily available. And yeah, it just, again, I think the wilderness setting overall creates an environment in which the people, whether it's kids or adults, can enter in and start to practice these skills in a way that they can see the effects very quickly. I think when you're in a clinical setting and you're seeing some people for like 1 hour a week or 1 hour every other week, you're not necessarily getting that compressed view of like what is effective over time. And so by adding the stressors of the natural environment, even if you're not doing a wilderness-based program, which often has kids living outside again for like 8 to 10 weeks, you might be, even if you're going on like a 2-hour hike with a client, you might start to see those skills happening more readily than over the length of time in the comfort of their home or in an office. Resilience, one of the things we talk a lot about in wilderness, not just therapy, but leadership, is the idea that being outside, learning self-efficacy does increase resilience in people. Like we see this time and time again. And there, I'll show a couple of examples of that. Empowerment's kind of a part of that. Resilience, trust in your guides, trust in yourself, trust in the group is quintessential in having a positive therapeutic experience in the outdoors. Self-efficacy, obviously. Interpersonal communication, again, within the group, within your guide relationship, is critical. And one thing that will come into play later on in the presentation are the things mind-body connection and the breath regulation piece. So with mind-body connection, you're literally embarking on a physical adventure, if you will. And oftentimes when you're doing those things, it becomes a lot easier for people to start noticing what their body is doing. And if they can do it in a way where it's very exaggerated, like rock climbing or yoga even, where it's like, oh, my body's doing this and I'm starting to feel my heart race and my palms are sweaty and I'm definitely very scared, they then can take that and translate it into their daily lives and be able to maybe increase their body awareness, which then can impact positively any kind of trauma work that they're doing. Same goes with the breath regulation. If you are doing an active type of wilderness experience, teaching clients breathing skills not only enhances their physical performance, which this is not about training for an ultra marathon or anything like that, but it teaches them, you know, if you slow down your breath, you might not panic as much. Or, you know, if you stop on a hike and rest and catch your breath, you'll notice that like you're breathing really shallow and really heavy and really quickly. And so it again is kind of heightening the awareness and sort of kind of like a pressure cooker, if you will. All right. Oh, why won't you let me? Okay. One of the things that wilderness therapists talk about a lot is, and I think you see this probably in art therapy too, I would imagine, although I'm not an art therapist, is the use of metaphor in storytelling. You know, the use of nature and metaphor, we're going to do a little exercise soon and you'll see, but it transcends everything from poetry to music to art and including therapy. We'll just go. So for example, some of the metaphors we use, you know, in Utah, we have unique access to the desert. Well, desert plants are resilient. They grow and are beautiful in the face of drought, in the face of extreme heat. Oftentimes they have protective features like this cactus plant that you see, and yet we're attracted to them and they flourish. And they're part of a vaster ecosystem. So again, going into this idea of ecotherapy and using wilderness as like a bigger metaphor, we can begin to talk to people about what their role is in a system, how they play into their own ecosystem, whether that's their family, their friend groups, their romantic relationships, anything like that. And we can draw infinite metaphor from a cactus flower. Same goes with waves in the ocean, right? A lot of times we hear in trauma work, like talking about patients kind of like riding those waves or teaching patients how to ride waves. In yoga-based trauma therapy, we talk about the ujjayi breath, which mimics the sound of a wave. The constriction of the back of your throat kind of creates this like hushing sound. And so again, we're already bringing in the wilderness into the office by using these kind of metaphors. The last one, which this is actually a story, going back to the idea of, let's see, resilience, self-efficacy, interpersonal communication, maybe an increase in the window of tolerance. You'll see, so I used to work at a wilderness therapy program and I ran their family expeditions. So I would take the families of these kids on weekends out in the West Desert and we would just camp together and do family therapy for 3 days straight. Very intense, very effective, very good, mostly. this was a particular day. I had a family from Chicago. They had never been outside, really. They had never slept outside. They had never eaten outside. They had never pooped outside. They were very, very much city people. And we were driving through and it was really snowy. And I had chains on the truck and the chains broke. And so we got out and the dad, who's an engineer, we start problem solving, trying to figure out, you know, and there's no cell service. So it's like, what are we going to do? We can't really get up and over this pass without them. And so finally the dad, after a few, maybe like 20, 30 minutes really of like trying to dig out the truck and trying to figure it out, looked at my keys, and on my keychain, I have this little carabiner to like clip to my backpack or my, you know, belt or whatever. And he was like, well, what if we use that? And so we took the carabiner off, and obviously used it to link the chain back together and we're able to fix it. And so we were able to use that experience that we went through together to then talk about it and use it in a therapeutic way. One of the core things besides metaphor, I would say, in wilderness therapy is the use of the debrief. You really can't do anything in any wilderness setting, that's whether that's wilderness leadership or wilderness therapy, without doing a lot of debriefing. And so we were able to use this story to talk about how his son was doing out in the desert and how his son had been able to like use the tools that he had in order to make changes and help himself. And so it really kind of gave the parents a very concrete feeling of what their kid might be feeling. And that was a pretty powerful thing for them. Another thing I have here, just some pretty pictures of different places around, you know, waterfall. Again, I think these slides are kind of representing metaphor, beach, cobblestone stuff. You know, we can draw metaphor from taking one step at a time, taking your time, slowing down, because otherwise you'll twist an ankle. And then the picture on the left is from an activity called busting. And busting is a way of making fire, it's primitive fire, using wood and stone and cordage, and that's about it. And so you make a coal base out of the kind of shavings that come from this friction fire, and eventually you can blow it into flame. And within that activity is, I mean, I could do a whole presentation on the power of busting a coal. It provides that self-efficacy. It is very hard and very frustrating. So you're learning about self-soothing, you're learning to increase your window of tolerance. I mean, the amount of people I've seen like throw their entire set across the desert and curse, there are a lot of them. But then it's about fixing that rupture and coming back to it. And that again is a very translatable skill, right? We talk a lot in therapy, especially in relational therapy, about it's not about the conflict or the rupture that happens in a relationship. It's what we do with it afterwards. Like, how do we make that repair? And so there are all these ways to kind of do that within that context. All right. So we're going to do a little activity, do a time check. All right. We're doing okay. I'm going to share a poem. It's a nature-based poem by Wendell Berry. He's one of my favorite poets. And then I'm going to have just a few questions afterwards. And if you're comfortable, I'd like us all to kind of share the answers to those questions. So I will go. Okay. I'll read it. When despair for the world grows in me, and I wake in the night at the least sound, in fear of what my life and my children's lives may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water, and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things who do not tax their lives with forethought or of grief. I come into the presence of still water, and I feel above me the day blind stars waiting with their light. For a time I rest in the grace of the world and am free. So I guess I should have prefaced the activities that we're going to do throughout the rest of this presentation are hopefully things that you can see how wilderness, nature, eco is impacting that intervention, and it doesn't require you to like go out into the woods. And so something like this is hopefully something that is translatable for you and that you can use with your clients wherever it is you're working. Okay, so these are the questions. We'll kind of look over them and we can go back, because I realized that we'll have to kind of switch back and forth. But the first one is, what emotions does this poem evoke? So we'll go back here. And if you want, I can read again, but yeah. Oh, go ahead, Laura.
Makes me feel really peaceful and calm.
Are there words or phrases or imagery within the poem that kind of do that for you specifically?
Yeah. I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water. There's that kind of image of lying down in the forest. And then the other phrase of, I come into the presence of still water. Mm-hmm. That also evokes an image of being by a lake or something and just watching the water feels really nice.
Yeah, I can like put myself there. I see Bill nodding along.
Yeah, but before we got to that part of the sort of existential grief of living, of not only worrying about the stuff that is, but worrying about the stuff that might be, kind of the forethought of grief, of getting all upset about how am I going to handle the stuff that I don't even know exists, or the things, the tragedies that might happen to me. And that's a weight we all carry all day, every day. And I don't know if wilderness does this, but when you're out in the wilderness, you can't be worried about what's going to happen next Tuesday, because you have to pay attention to your next step. Exactly. It doesn't feel dangerous, but it means that you have to attend to it. And right. Because I have to attend to my next step, I can't get distracted by my usual worries of what's going to happen next Tuesday. So yeah. It somewhat frees me of the forethought of grief.
I like that phrase. I never heard it. Yeah, I mean, I think you're spot on. And one thing that I didn't really have time to go into in this presentation is exactly what you talked about, how wilderness and nature experience requires a certain amount of presence that is very mindful, which we all know at this point does psychological wonders for us and our clients. So yeah, thank you. Would you like to share it all, Christina? Definitely don't have to, but just if you have anything to add.
Just that I like, I mean, kind of just repeating what was said, but I like that reading the poem from the beginning to end, I could feel an emotional shift. Mm-hmm. That the poet does a really good job of putting you in his shoes, of beginning with kind of some despair and anxiety, and then moving from that into calm and a peace.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I feel by the end of the poem, I feel a lot of hope. And I think that kind of he talks about the peace, the peace of wild things, but that feeling of like what is, and I will be okay, which I think is something that a lot of our clients are working to internalize. The next question, we kind of did that. And this will kind of tie into our next activity. People are, feel free to share, but, you know, does this poem remind you of a place in your own life? And if so, what does that place evoke for you?
Oh, it reminds me of so many places.
Great.
So many places in nature that and really a feeling of connectivity, of like belonging to something bigger than myself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that, yeah.
A couple days ago, I for some random reason I was thinking about a hike I took through the whole rainforest, which is a rainforest in the Olympia Peninsula in Washington. And nobody was there. And I had this forest to myself. And it was as close to spiritual as I have ever been. I'm not a religious person, but majesty and wonder and awe and something so much bigger and more magnificent than myself, that I felt small, but not in a bad way. A way that my little worries didn't matter because of this wondrous big thing of this forest. And you know, you can feel it's not energy, but you can feel the awe of it all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Definitely. This photo was taken near there in Oregon, but Pacific Northwest at least. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think, again, you both hit on this really important thing, especially when we're doing things like existential therapy, of connecting to something bigger than ourselves. Whether that, and when we say spirituality, we're not necessarily talking about God or energy or anything like that. It's a sense of connectedness. And, you know, when we're talking about things like mood disorders, especially things like depression, there's a marked lack of feeling connected to anything. And so having these kinds of experiences, even if it's just reading a poem, most people have a place that they can think of when they read something like this that makes them feel the same way. Right. Unless you have anything else to add, Laura, then I'm gonna go to the next one. Okay. All right. So I'm just gonna land on this photo for a minute. This was an expedition that I guided last August, so like a year ago from August, down in Grand Staircase with the therapeutic backpacking company that I started with a friend. And we were doing a body positivity trip. So it was open to anybody in any shape, form, gender, any of it. And the focus of these trips are therapeutic, is therapeutic. And we talk a lot about the things that we just talked about with the poem on these trips. And it brings up a lot of just natural conversations, which is great. But one of the things I wanted to talk about, again, that specifically links to wilderness experience, whether we're talking about an expedition, like an overnight backpacking trip or a whitewater rafting trip or anything like that, or if we're talking about going climbing with a client at the gym, or going on a hike with a client. And we can talk, there'll be times at the end for questions, hopefully. And, you know, if you guys have questions about liability or anything like that, we can go over that. But unlike most therapy practices, the practitioner has to be involved in many of the activities because oftentimes the practitioner is the facilitator. Unless you're hiring an outside guide and you're just kind of coming as like the therapeutic arm of the trip, which happens and is very effective. But the practitioner is in the environment, so that the power dynamic that we often run into in clinical therapy, where, you know, the ideas of like transference and countertransference get a little bit flipped on their head, because you're in it too. You know, if it's raining and the tent breaks, like it's your tent too. And so it really very quickly creates a sense of trust. It also helps, like in terms of rapport building, it happens very fast. Typically in wilderness settings, because there's that sense of like, we're all in this together. Going into the experience, if you do facilitate, or when one facilitates, it's important that you do work on your self-work, because there will probably be times when self-disclosure is not only appropriate, but like crucial and an important part of the group. And so you kind of have to decide, especially if you're going out places with a client, you know, how much am I going to share? What am I going to share? What I'm not going to share? How am I going to approach this topic if it does come up? Things like that. So, because the group can very quickly become like a family system. So one of the examples I give, oh, here we go. So this is another, it's a writing workshop that I ran in Escalante. I'm in the plaid, kind of in the middle, and that's my dog. And in this writing circle, we were talking about, I don't know exactly, but it was right after we had gotten to Lower Calf Creek Falls, which is a beautiful waterfall down in southern Utah. And we were writing about our feelings and kind of what had come up for us. And I think we were talking about like where we were this time last year, like emotionally, physically. And I decided to share about a client that I had who died, who like the year before I was actually at Lower Calf Creek Falls. And that's when I received news of his death. And so that was a really important moment for the group, I think, and a good example of how I was able to share something that I felt was appropriate to the group dynamic and felt safe enough within my wheelhouse that I could do it without creating any kind of boundary violation. So the group, where am I? Like I said, the group can very quickly become like a family system. And if you pay attention, you really begin to see the roles that the participants slide into naturally, pretty much off the bat. And those often mirror the ways, the roles that they play when they're in a family system. And so what's really cool about having groups out in the wilderness, and you can do this with individuals too, but you, if you've done your work and you're paying attention, you can then use yourself as a tool to start to disrupt the system. And that's when it becomes kind of a structural, very like Virginia Satir style family, like family therapy, which is my favorite. So for example, oftentimes when I was out there with families, I would always ask the kids for help instead of the parents. And I would encourage the kids to be the leaders of the day and things like that. So we're really disrupting the family's like status quo, you know, and we would play games and initiatives that kind of exaggerate those roles as well. And we can do things like, you know, we would be playing a game of like capture the flag and dad's not allowed to talk at all throughout the whole game. And so now we have this dad who likes to be in control and tell people what to do and lecture, not being able to do any of that at all. And so we get to not only debrief again, the kids' experience of what it felt like to maybe have a little bit more power and a little more say, but also maybe the dad's internal anxiety of what it feels like to let go and kind of let the system play out as it will. And so that's been a really amazing thing to witness. And, you know, if you have good therapeutic relationships with any of the people in the group, you can also hopefully start to point out to them the dynamics that they're slipping into. You know, I notice that you're always the one that jumps up to do the dishes after we've done eating, or I notice in the morning, you're the last one to show up, you know, or you're avoiding talking whenever we're all, you know, whenever we're all eating lunch together around the watering hole, you kind of like skulk off by yourself. Like, what's that about? And so it can kind of give you a really unique window into how people react in the real world that you really only see in things like residential treatment. But it's kind of taking residential treatment and putting it outside for a minute. So during walk and talk sessions, if we're going kind of back into like more of a city setting, I often will adjust my pace to meet my clients rather than the other way around. So if I notice that they're out of breath, I'll intentionally slow down and tie my shoe or find a bench that I'd like to rest in. It's also a really great way for you to start modeling self-care with your clients. So things like, I need to take a water break, or I need to tape up this hot spot on my foot because I'm about to get a blister. So you're modeling for them self-advocacy, you're modeling self-care. It makes it a much safer place for them to want to open up and be able to do the same thing. Boo, 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 boo. Okay. My notes are kind of like all over the place. All right. I'll do that time check. Okay, cool. So this next activity is an ecotherapy one, and I really like it. And it's called an eco map. Has anyone done this before? No? Okay. Maybe?
A little in one, like classes, but not in real life.
Okay. Cool.
I think.
Yeah, right.
I've done it in like a family systems way, but not necessarily related to like ecology.
Okay, gotcha. Okay, well, this will be hopefully you'll like this as much as I do. And I just incorporated Gary Snyder's a poet and a beatnik and all those things. All of us carry within us a picture of the terrain that was learned roughly between the ages of 6 and 9. It could as easily be an urban neighborhood as a rural scene. You can almost totally recall the place you walked, played, biked, swam. Revisualizing that place with its smells and textures, walking through it again in your imagination, has a grounding and settling effect. So, you know, if any of you are familiar with the stages of EMDR, which we'll get into towards the end, one of the first things that you ever do is establish a safe or peaceful place with your client, a place that internally they can go to self-regulate again. And so I've found that this, in conjunction with doing just the internal visualization, can really help solidify, I think probably some of those neural pathways. So let's see. So I'd like you all to take out a piece of paper, if you have it. And I'll do it too. I need to get a piece of paper. But we're gonna take a few minutes to draw a map, an actual map. I'm just gonna use a sticky note. Of a place in nature that you recall experiencing between the ages of 6 and 9. And this is also when you're especially working in the trauma field, you want to be aware of your client's trauma history. You know, if they were going through a particularly traumatic event between 6 and 9, you might choose a different time period. But oftentimes things like natural setting will have a positive, like it may not be kind of interrelational. And so it's maybe a little bit safer, but you can always kind of underscore, like, please pick like a safe place where you had positive memories. But yeah, go ahead and draw a map of what it looks like. And within this, it's asking us to imagine any kind of sensory input that we would have had. So smell, taste, sound, touch, any of those things can be included. And we'll just take a few more moments we'll wrap up. If you feel, is anyone not ready? Okay. So if you're comfortable, I'd like you to share this place and I can always go first. Kind of answering these questions, just anything you feel safe sharing. Is that a hand, Laura, or are you adjusting your microphone?
Well, I saw Bill was unmuted, so I wondered if he wanted to go first.
So I will tell you about my place. So I grew up on my house was about 100 yards in a little neighborhood near the shoreline of Lake Erie. And so Lake Erie, the shoreline, was my play place. And I can remember many memories of, you know, walking along the beach, which wasn't sand, it was more of gravel and kind of the crunch of the gravel under my feet. And sort of the lapping noises of the lake, which was usually calm. Sometimes in rough weather, it got torrential, it got amazingly powerful, but mostly it was gentle lapping up against the shore. And I don't remember any smells about it, but I do remember the crunch of the gravel under my feet and the lapping noises of the little waves, you know, 2 or 3 inch waves lapping up against the gravel. So.
Like that. Thank you. I know that.
And it surprises me that I remembered so many details. I did map it out, and including the orientation of my house and the orientation of the school and the fact that we crossed the schoolyard to get to the beach, and we had to cross a four-lane highway to get there. I mean, just sort of like, oh yeah, there's a lot of stuff on this map.
Yeah, I mean, I think that speaks to how much the memories of positive space really stick with us. Even it's like a muscle memory. It's like riding a bike. You kind of just remember it all of a sudden. Did you have any, as you were mapping it out, did you have any emotional or physical responses?
Well, I mentioned I was drawing it and I was picturing the waves lapping up against the shore, but I also when I was a teenager, during storms, I would go down and stand on the beach and just feel the power of the wind and the crashing of waves that, you know, in the Lake Erie can be 5 or 6 feet tall, and not in a frightened way, but in a way that helped me sort of deal with the crashing emotions I was feeling as a teenager. Yeah. And I don't know, recognizing the same power that was quite a little scary, but also power that was sort of majestic. So when I was drawing, I sort of flashed to a couple of those memories of storms on the lake.
That's awesome. Thank you for sharing that.
I can share too. I grew up in LA, but there was a park kind of close to my house called Pollywog Park. And same kind of thing where once I started drawing it out, I was like, oh, wow, I remember a lot about this place. And I loved doing the sensory work. Like I could, the smell of grass, and there's a big pond, and the smell of the pond and that water. The sound of ducks and seagulls and like other people talking in the background. And then a sound popped into my head and it took me a minute. I was like, wait, what is that sound? I couldn't, like, I could hear it, but I couldn't put an identifier to it. And then it clicked in my head. It was like, oh, it was the sound of like the chains squeaking on the swing set on the playground. So that was funny, the way that, like, that was just there. It took me a minute for my conscious brain to catch up to that sensory memory.
Yeah, that is wild. That's so cool. Yeah, I mean, I think you, as you both kind of described, I mean, as soon as you start writing, you're starting to do some sort of bilateral stimulation, which we'll get into in just a minute. And so it's already like priming the pump for getting into that processing mode. So you're thinking creatively in here, but then you're also having to translate it. And so it's kind of wild what comes up versus if I, you know, if I had sat here and just said, like, close your eyes and explain to me, you know, your favorite place when you were this age, it may have been a little more difficult to draw up as many details. I can go. Mine's on a sticky note and it's bad. It's a bad drawing, but I grew up in Oklahoma and I grew up maybe like a quarter mile from this little river. It was really more of a creek, that ran through our town. And every day after school, when I was around that age, I would ride my bike to that place and spend, I was there basically until it got dark. In fact, I think the only time I ever was grounded was because I came back after dark. And I would just follow the little creek as far as I could in each direction. And yeah, I smelled rotting leaves, usually, yeah, like that kind of fall smell. I could like sense like humidity. And I kind of what you were saying, Christina, is like I was having this smell memory that I couldn't really place. And then I realized it's like it was a metallic smell that came from this like giant pipe, like irrigation pipe that would pump out water. And so it was kind of cool to like reverse engineer that memory.
I'll share too. So I drew a picture of the house that I grew up in from when like age 3 to like 10 was like the coolest childhood house ever. And we had this ginormous tree in our front yard, like right in front of our house, that I remember, like, I would love to climb up it, like, and go to the very top. And I remember particularly around spring, it had really beautiful flowers that smelled really good. And I just remember climbing up in that tree and just hanging out in the tree pretty often and smelling the flowers. And just, I feel like my, like that time period, I have a lot of really good memories, from my childhood. And so that kind of elicits like all of these other memories associated with that tree. So yeah.
Overall positive experience.
Mm-hmm.
That's good. Great. Thank you for sharing.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So we'll go into kind of like the last section, which is the trauma processing piece of how wilderness and natural environment can help when we're working with clients who have, you know, diagnoses like PTSD or complex PTSD. And I realized I never got introductions, so I don't know what everyone's background is. So thank you for bearing with me if you're sitting here and you're like, oh yeah, I've gone through every EMDR training there is. So I am by no means an expert. But here's one from the good old Book of Van der Kolk. In order to change, people need to become aware of their sensations and the way that their bodies interact with the world around them. Physical self-awareness is the first step in releasing the tyranny of the past. Here's just we'll be going over kind of like these specific pictures and how they kind of relate. So just take it in. We have me very poorly backcountry skiing for the first time. We have a fire going. And then we have a man that I was working with who is backpacking also in Grand Staircase. So we know that Francine Shapiro created EMDR while walking in a local park. She kind of realized that she became desensitized as she was doing that to some difficult emotions. And so through that, you know, fast forward for the last 30 plus years, we now understand a lot more about bilateral stimulation and that it doesn't, it's not reduced solely to eye movement. We're talking about any kind of act that is crossing the corpus callosum, which goes from like left to right brain. So when we're doing things outside, whether it's walking or skiing or even watching a fire, because our eyes are moving as we're watching fire, those are examples of how we can create bilateral stimulation in the outdoors. Okay. This was a new one. I didn't add this, but I can add it in the notes later on. But same with the first phases of EMDR. The next stage, right, we have the resource development and installation phase of EMDR, which is kind of like the positive cognition that we want clients to start to instill. So participants here are creating internal and external resources throughout their experience in real time, which is what's really cool. And they're able to practice these skills within the group, and it gives them a safe and contained place to try their new skills and ways of thinking. And so when they have this group, like I said, kind of at the beginning, they're learning things quickly and they're integrating them quickly. And you're getting to witness it as their clinician in real time, which is invaluable to your work together. Breath regulation. So, you know, we'll have clients focus on their exhalations, especially when they're hiking. Not only does that help with like feeling that feeling of being like constantly out of breath, but it's teaching them how to soothe themselves by triggering the parasympathetic nervous system, which we know now that through exhalation and sighing and things like that, we are starting to like stimulate that system of rest and restore and relaxation. So that's pretty cool. another thing that we're seeing a lot, I'm sure many of you have heard of different veteran expedition programs where they take veterans who have PTSD out on these crazy expeditions and they do wild adventures. And the idea behind that, I mean, there's a lot of kind of reasons behind that, but one of the things that I really am interested in and attached to is the idea of external versus internal anxiety. Kind of going back to what Bill said about learning about presence and mindfulness. So when we're in an outdoor setting, in an adventure setting at least, we are allowing clients in a safe and controlled way to arouse their stress hormones, like cortisol, like adrenaline, be able to soothe themselves, and be able to ascribe those stress hormones to something that's more appropriate than what they're doing in their daily life. Because one of the things we know about PTSD is that those hormones are flooding the system in inappropriate times. So when we can recalibrate the system to be like, oh no, this is when I actually feel like I'm in danger, when I'm rock climbing or when I'm whitewater rafting or whatever. It really starts to rewire our brain and can teach our brain, kind of give it a jump start into what's actually worth stressing over and what's not. Moving on. Sorry. Can you tell it's Friday? Okay. So next point is the idea of addressing hypoarousal. So we often see in clients with PTSD that they tend to either go into hyperarousal or hypoarousal whenever they're triggered. This happens with anybody. It doesn't have to come with a trauma diagnosis, but we see this especially. And hypoaroused clients are often harder to work with and harder to treat because they maybe are so numbed out that they don't, when we ask things like, well, what do you notice? Especially when we're doing things like EMDR, where do you feel it in your body? A lot of times the answer will be like, I don't feel anything. And so by having these outdoor experiences or physical experiences in any way, we're giving them, again, some kind of baseline of like what their body actually starts to feel like. And it can start to activate those neuropathways that have been diminished because of their hypoarousal. And, you know, we started seeing this initially with, Bessel van der Kolk talks a lot about it in his work in trauma-based yoga therapy, where yoga has really helped clients to interpret what's going on in their body and give them more of a concrete example of what's happening so that when they go into a triggered state, they can identify it, which is very important for moving through it. And so my hypothesis is that, and it's backed by a lot, is that the same happens in any kind of physical activity, things like rock climbing, things like hiking, which also goes into the last point, which is this flow state that people describe, which again is kind of that heightened level of presence and meditate, like in a meditative state almost. And we like to say that this is different than hyperfocus, which we see in clients with like ADHD and things like that, because you are able to kind of transition out of it. And so when I was working at Outward Bound, we talk a lot about what's called the stretch zone. So we have three concentric circles. I should have probably put this graphic in the presentation, but inside we have our comfort zone. Farthest out, we have our stress zone, which no growth really happens in either of those zones. And then right in the middle is where we have that stretch zone. And so oftentimes in the stretch zone is when we're seeing people go into flow state. And that flow state can really be healing in terms of refocusing, having presence, again, going into this kind of like meditative awareness state, which is very helpful in processing trauma. So the fifth, let me check time. I'm doing okay. I mean, this one really, we're not going to go that deep into because I'm sure you already have heard of a lot of this, but like, and it's pretty simple, but the idea of like five things you see, you know, when we're using grounding techniques with our clients, especially, you know, if they've gone into a dissociative state, one thing we know about the outdoors is that those senses are a lot more aroused. So we can literally say, what do you hear? What do you smell? What do you taste? And they may have a more concrete example than hearing like the HVAC in your office and or your sound machine, which is what my clients, they're like, I still just hear your sound machine and that's it. So that's kind of the activity that I was alluding to in this slide. So I do want to talk just briefly about critiques and contraindications for this type of therapy, for the idea of wilderness therapy in general. The classical type of wilderness therapy that we're talking about in Utah that I used to work is very cost prohibitive. Insurance does not cover it and it is very expensive. And so it creates that a real socioeconomic problem. A lot of times it can, the outdoor world in general can be ableist. And there can be these ideas of like whose bodies belong in the outdoors. But hopefully through this presentation, you can see that being outside doesn't mean climbing Everest. It can also mean hanging out by a tree in a backyard. And that really nature is pretty much everywhere if we are looking at it in the right light. And so anybody can access it. This one's important. This one I hadn't really thought of, but I was working with a woman from North Carolina whose husband is Black, and they went on a hike and he was able to remember that historically the area where they were hiking was an area that had a former plantation where a lot of, there was a lot of slavery, a lot of abuse, obviously, racial transgressions. And so for him being in that area wasn't relaxing. He was just thinking about the history of that place. And so when you're working with people, you do want to be aware that for some people, the outdoors is not a safe place, or certain areas aren't a safe place. And so with that, you can start to use more urban setting ideas. And that again, just goes back to reiterating and enforcing that idea of with your clients of like, where are your safe places? I say, I wouldn't do any of this with someone who has a really high dissociative experiences scale number, because if you are out there trauma processing and they do become dissociated, it can be a safety, a physical safety hazard. And then all of a sudden you have a dissociated person in the wilderness that you're trying to kind of reground. And that is a very stressful experience. And then lastly, this one's kind of goes without saying, but if you can't ensure their physical safety in whatever you're doing, then you probably shouldn't be doing it. All right. So the final thing is just, well, this is a question slide, but I'm going to share this presentation with Laura and she'll be able to email it to y'all. But these are just some additional resources that I came across. And then obviously my information's at the bottom. The first one is a YouTube video by this guy whose name is, his trail name is Akuna. And he did a really beautiful video through Merrill, which is the shoe company, about his experience as a combat war veteran hiking the Pacific Crest Trail and how that helped with him processing his trauma. Last Child in the Woods is a great book. Ah, there you go. Yeah, she's got it. She knows. Shouting at the Sky is a brief history, pretty biased, honestly, about like the classical wilderness therapy model that we see in Utah. Adventure Group Psychotherapy, great book on techniques and interventions. And kind of like why adventure therapy and experiential therapy works. Same with that. And then this is a book of poetry that I really like that I've been pulling from with clients called Black Nature, Four Centuries of African American Nature Poetry, just because I feel like we often look to like Thoreau and Emerson and all these great poets, Walt Whitman, But there are plenty of like Black poets that have been around for centuries that are writing about the same things. And then the last one is National Institute of Mental Health and their kind of breakdown of why BLS works. That stands for bilateral stimulation. So with that, does anyone have questions, comments, things that we want to discuss? We have 13 minutes.
I have a question. I'm not sure how to phrase it. Somewhere along the way, now, first of all, I'm not a therapist. I'm a retired pediatrician. So I don't have a deep background in any of this stuff. But somewhere I read that in therapeutic encounters or in encounters where you're trying to motivate somebody, that just getting up and moving, walking with them, opens up some psychic doors to help them change. And I've not found any other reference to it, but I wondered, one, is it real? And two, how does it relate to this kind of therapy? Because in fact, you're walking along with the client rather than sitting across the table from them. It's a little different power manifestation too, but somehow movement gets involved. So any thoughts?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. And I apologize retroactively for all the jargon. But yeah, I think that this article that talks about bilateral stimulation might help you understand or at least come up with more questions. But you're not wrong. I mean, I think what Francine Shapiro began in the therapeutic community was this understanding that that movement kind of unlocks different neuro pathways that allow clients to think more creatively. It also, so things like when we're walking and we're going back and forth between our hemispheres, right, left, it's actually causing a calming effect. Same with when our breath becomes regulated with that movement. And that tends to diminish our fight, flight, freeze response, which then allows for more creative processing, more flexible mindset. And so movement alone really can start to grease the wheels of like internal motivation and things like that. So I don't know if that answers your question specifically.
Well, it sounds like magic, and you answered it with more magic. But so let me ask a different question, because I believe in this magic. So I don't mean that magic pejoratively. It's just that power that we can't understand is what I mean by magic.
Yeah.
Is the bilateral walking by hemisphere thing, does that help our parasympathetic nervous system elevates to therefore decrease our sympathetic nervous system? Is there a connection there in the parasympathetic pathways and hormones, or is it something else?
That is a good question that I don't entirely know the answer to. But that article, again, that I've included at the bottom of this slide, talks about the experience that the participants have with bilateral stimulation and how it relaxes and provides a sense of calmness. And so because of that reaction, I would assume that it is triggering the parasympathetic nervous system as well, because that is the overarching system that is used to relax us. So there's really not another one. So I would assume that they're probably inextricably linked, but I couldn't point you to like a specific article at this moment. But yeah, it does feel like magic. And there's a lot that we don't understand. It's always funny when I hear clinicians explaining EMDR, eye and movement desensitization and reprocessing, because it sounds like hocus pocus. And when people are like, well, but how? And the answer is like, we don't really know. Like, we think it's mirroring REM sleep, which is that bilateral movement also might be mirroring some kind of REM experience, which if you're in REM, you're asleep, which means your parasympathetic nervous system has taken over. But again, 10 years from now, we might be like, oh, that wasn't it at all.
And now I'm going to ask another question. And I don't know much about EMDR, but I've also seen reference to connecting it to tapping in a rhythmic way to also trigger those same responses. And again, I don't know, but tapping is a vibration, and it's predictable in cycles, and it seems like walking again is sort of that vibration sense that is rhythmic and consistent. And I'm sort of again wondering if the tapping and walking are doing the same thing, because tapping wouldn't be a bilateral stimulation. It wouldn't be using the corpus callosum and triggering that effect. It would be sensory only, I think. I don't know.
So actually, yes, you're correct. And the tapping actually does cross the corpus callosum. Especially, I saw Christina was doing what we call this, like the butterfly tapping. So you're creating sensation bilaterally, you're crossing your arms. So,
and you're doing the motion. So again, I'm still
predicting. Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. But yeah, I mean, the whole kind of point that I'm trying to make is that things that we do in a wilderness or outdoor setting are doing the same thing that clinicians are trying to do in their therapeutic practice, like in an office.
Okay.
Thanks for asking those questions. Anyone else? Right. Well, please, if any other questions come up, I'm very reachable. and I love talking about this stuff. So please don't hesitate to email. Christina, are you, I gathered that you are a clinician?
Yeah, I'm a clinician trained in EMDR and use that in practice along with a lot of mindfulness.
Yeah. You know, I offer this, like, if there are clinicians that are interested in incorporating things like walk and talk therapy, which is kind of like the gateway drug into this, I'm happy to discuss kind of like liability and how that works and HIPAA and privacy things that come up with taking your clients outside. Yeah, go ahead, Laura.
Yeah, actually, now that you mentioned that, I do have questions around what you just said. And also just thinking about, like, I don't know, where I meet clients for therapy at the Mill Creek office at Healing Pathways, it doesn't feel like a really good walking area. Do you like meet clients at parks, or like what's your strategy?
Yeah, I meet them at parks typically, or on local trails, Mill Creek mostly. The strategy for me has to be kind of proactive in terms of when I'm having them sign all their paperwork. I go into kind of, I have them sign an additional waiver that basically says, you're entering into this willingly. And if you like trip and fall, you're not going to sue me. Mm-hmm. And in conjunction with that, so I have my typical liability license that you kind of just get as a clinician. And then on top of that, there are insurance companies that insure more like outdoor related activities, such as hiking and things like that. And so I have that as well. The thing that can be difficult and is kind of a weird gray area still is the idea of permitting. So if you were to run like a big group and take them somewhere, you would probably need permits from either like the Bureau of Land Management, which is what I typically do, or other US Forest Service. But things like the park, if you're meeting an individual client one-on-one, there's no real precedent for that. And so I've noticed that there's no need for permitting in that regard that I found. And so oftentimes, like you were, so I worked at that office. And so what I would do with clients who were interested in walk and talk would be like, we're going to meet at Sugar House Park at this time. And I send them a little pin of where I'll be. And then we just like do a couple laps.
Cool. And I'm guessing when you do that kind of thing, you're kind of making the decision ahead of time to like not do EMDR or something like that.
Yeah, I would use those sessions more as the kind of reset sessions between EMDR sessions. So like kind of getting them back in their bodies, a little more regulated. Sometimes they just want to kind of shoot the shit. Sorry for my language, which kind of helps. And so, yeah, I'm not actively doing EMDR outside.
Cool.
Yeah.
I love that idea because a lot of my clients, yeah, they don't want to do reprocessing every session back to back. Create a really good rhythm. I've done some outdoor workshops at parks before, and you know, my supervisor, the head of my agency that I work for, has had me do like a separate waiver of liability for those events. It always freaks my clients out when I have them sign those things. I'm wondering if you have any suggestions for smoothing that process or making that a little more comfortable for the client. And also, how does that work if it's more of a like, because these are just single events, right? So it says this is the time and the day and the place of the event. But if it's more of a ongoing treatment plan that you have with the client, how does that work?
Mm-hmm. Good question. I'll answer the first part first, which is, my go-to would be to be transparent with them in terms of just saying like, really, we're just going to a park to do the same thing that we would do in an office. It's just that our insurance hasn't caught up. And so like, it's easy to insure a building. It's less easy to insure an outdoor space. And so that's why we're having you sign this. And sometimes that can kind of help. It's like, this isn't dangerous, right? We're just sitting on a park bench. It's just, you know, we don't know if you're going to run into your neighbor or your boyfriend or whatever. And so this is also covering like the fact that we're not in an enclosed environment that I can completely control. And so then the second one, let me see if I understood your question. So it was like, what if it's more of like a consistent part of the treatment plan, and what, and like how to do that, or how
just kind of related to the waiver of liability, because when I've done that before, it's like, you know, covering this space on this day for this time, as opposed to if it's like something you might be doing every other week with a client.
Yeah, that's a great. So with that, I typically do kind of a state of the union with my clients every year, where I update my policies and kind of go over if my prices have changed and things like that. And so I would kind of include that in there and maybe just put a window of time of like, you know, from like in the year of 2023, or if you want to do like, you know, seasonal things. One of the things I've noticed is that people don't want to do this in the winter for a lot of reasons. So I'll do it kind of seasonally. So it'll be like, okay, April through September or October. And I'll put that in the liability forms. Like at any point we could be doing this if you feel, and again, it's all about kind of giving your client that control of if they even want to. But I've found since opening up this side of my practice, like that's like mostly what people want, except for when it's like dark and cold and rainy.
Okay, great. Thank you. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, you're welcome. Anything else? Oh, well, this was great. I'm glad we had a small group because, yeah, we got to dive into some cool stuff. And I hope you learned something new. And I hope I see you at a TICN event again.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks so much for presenting for us. I really loved the experiential parts. And I feel like I have more questions for you, but maybe I'll shoot you an email or something.
Yeah, please do. Please do. Any feedback is very welcome. So thank you all for being here.
Are you only available via email or do you have other social media?
I don't have any other social media at this time. Yeah, I've purposely taken myself offline. So
totally understand. Thank you so much though. That was a fantastic experience.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear it. All right. See you all later.
Bye.